فليعمل عملا صالحا ولا يشرك بعبادة ربه أحدا. The scholar said Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala لا يقبل من العمل إلا أخلصه وأصوابه. The Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only accepts the deeds that are most sincere and most correct. Most sincere, which means your niyyah, your intention is purely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And most correct means you're doing it according to Sunnah al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that's an inherent part of the meaning of Muhammadun Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Part of believing that Muhammad is Rasulullah, as the scholars say, it translates into four things. تَصْدِيقُهُ فِيمَا أَخْبَرْ وَطَاعَتُهُ فِيمَا أَمْرْ وَالْإِنْتِهَاءُ عَمَّا نَهَى عَنْهُ وَزَجَرْ وَأَلَّا يُعْبَدَ اللَّهَ إِلَّا بِمَا شَعَرْ. When you bear witness that Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is Rasulullah, this entails four things. First, you believe in everything that he has told you through an authentic narration. And of course, Quran is on top. Second, you obey him in everything that he has commanded you to do. Third, you avoid things that he has forbidden you from doing. And fourth is you only worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in accordance with his sunnah. The only path to success and acceptance of your deeds is through the satisfaction of those two conditions. Al-ikhlas wal-mutaba'ah, sincerity in the deed and doing it according to the sunnah. So that's why the scholar said that this hadith almost covers half of your Islam, because it is dealing with the first part, which is your intention and your sincerity when you're doing the deed. So we'll start here with the hadith, inshallah, then we will briefly comment on it, inshallah. عن أمير المؤمنين أبي حفص عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه. Why do we call him Abi Hafs? Does anybody know?
Because he's the father of Hafsa.
Ahsant, mashallah. Because his daughter was Hafsa. And there is a notion in Arabic called At-Tarkhim, where you basically shorten the name of a person. So Sayyida Hafsa, Tarkhim is makan Hafs. Sayyida Aisha, the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used to call her Ya Aish. So عن أمير المؤمنين أبي حفص عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه قال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول إنما الأعمال بالنيات وإنما لكل امرئ ما نوى فمن كانت هجرته إلى الله ورسوله فهجرته إلى الله ورسوله ومن كانت هجرته لدنيا يصيبها أو إلى امرأة ينكحها فهجرته إلى ما هاجر إليه. This hadith is hadith متفق عليه. متفق عليه means that it was narrated by both Al-Bukhari and Muslim. This is the highest level of authenticity in hadith, that both Al-Bukhari and Muslim selected this hadith and included it in their book. Now also something about Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu, he was the first person who was named Amir al-Mu'mineen, the commander of the faithful. Because Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was called Khalifa Rasulullah, the Khalifa of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So after he died and then Sayyidina Umar became the Khalifa, they started calling him Ya Khalifa ta Khalifa ta Rasulullah. They said that's going to be taking so long. And then the next person will be Khalifa ta Khalifa ta Khalifa ta Rasulullah. So it was suggested by some of the Sahaba, I believe to Sayyidina Khalid bin Walid, that he would be called the commander of the faithful. Amir al-Mu'mineen Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. When did he embrace Islam? When did Sayyidina Umar embrace Islam? Which year? Did he embrace Islam before Hijrah or after Hijrah? Before or after?
After.
Before?
Before.
It was before Hijrah.
Before.
It was around the 6th year of Al-Ba'tha. He embraced Islam almost after 6 years of Al-Ba'tha. And see that, whenever you mention the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and you mention the people, the best mu'min after Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you say Sayyidina Abu Bakr, and then Umar. Sayyidina Umar embraced Islam in the 6th year, which means there had been many, many other people who have embraced Islam before him. But he caught up and he even excelled beyond them. So it's never too late. It all comes back to your sincerity and how hard work you can put to serve your religion. So we're going to read the hadith in English, inshallah. On the authority of the commander of the faithful, Abu Hafs, Umar ibn Khattab, radiallahu anhu, he said, I heard Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying, surely all actions are but driven by intention. And verily, every man shall have but that which he intended. In many hadiths, when you hear the word man or he, it doesn't mean specifically for men. And he said, وَشَقَائِقُ الرِّجَالِ, women and men are equal. So it's just the nature of the speech. So anything you hear in Quran and Sunnah talking about a man, or that they should be doing this, or he should be doing that, that applies to both men and women. They are equal. Thus, he whose migration was for Allah and His Messenger, then his migration was for Allah and His Messenger. And he whose migration was to achieve some worldly benefit or to marry a woman, his migration was for that to which he has migrated. That's the hadith. Now, there are several narrations, they are all coming to the same meaning. إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّةِ. And some narration says, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّةِ. They all have the same meaning. Now, this hadith, there is a story that rotates around that hadith. There was a person who wanted to marry a woman. Her name was Abu Qais. And now that man was in Mecca. And then he sent her a message saying, I would like to marry you. So she said that if you want to marry me, you will have to migrate to Al-Madinah. So he migrated to Al-Madinah to marry her. And that's why the Sahaba used to call him Muhajir Umm Qais. He made the hijrah for Umm Qais. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there is no specific, like the scholars do not say that this hadith was specifically said in that situation. But the scholars, when they explain that hadith, they always use that example to show you that even some of the most honorable actions in Islam, which is a hijrah, migration, sometimes you can do it for the wrong reasons and you're not gonna be getting the reward. Right? So that's what it actually, that's some of the reasons and not asbab al-nuzul, asbab al-harim. And that's a very important science when it comes to Quran and Sunnah. You should always search to see if there was a specific situation or occasion in which this ayah was revealed or that hadith was actually said. Now, an-niyya, innama, in Arabic, and innama tufid al-qasr. Qasr means emphasis and exclusiveness. So Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is saying the actions, your actions are except by your intention. What is the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is telling us here? That every action you do, definitely have an intention. Any action you do. Now here, we're talking about the actions that are related to Islam, the actions of worship, the actions that you are doing with the goal of trying to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when we're talking about the actions that you're trying to do to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we want to expand the meaning of the word ibadah, the word worship. Many times when we hear the word worship, what comes to mind is worship is praying or giving zakat or doing hajj. No. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah says, Al-ibadah hiya ismun jami'un likulli ma yuhibbuhu Allah wa yarda min al-aqwal wal-af'al al-batina wal-zahira. Worship is a collective term that covers everything you say or everything you do, whether internally with your heart, because you do actions with your heart, like love for Allah, like fear of Allah. These are actions that you do with your heart. So it is a collective term for all the actions that you do with your tongue, or you do with your heart, or you do with your lips, with the ultimate purpose of pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this hadith is talking about these kind of actions that you are doing for the sake of pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying, every action, every deed you're doing definitely has an intention. Now this intention could be noble or could be evil. And you will be surprised how many of us are doing actions which have very noble outward looking, but internally they are evil. And we'll get to that. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying that every action, every deed has an intention. وَإِنَّمَا لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مَا نَوَى. Another إِنَّمَا, another exclusiveness, another emphasis, that for every person, your reward will be based on your intention. Some people, when they read the hadith, they say there is a repetition. No, there is no repetition. This is the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَفْصَحَ الْعَرَبِ, the most eloquent speaker of Arabic. The first part is talking about the actions. The second part is talking about the rewards. So your rewards will be based on your intention. That's what the second part means. Now, the intention. First of all, the intention differentiates two things. Differentiates to whom you're doing the action. Are you doing it for the sake of Allah, or are you doing it for somebody else's sake? And now we get to the importance of intention. We are all standing in line praying in Maghrib or praying in Isha, right? Or even after praying in Maghrib, people are starting to pray Sunnah. Outwardly, you are satisfying the second condition, which is following the Sunnah. Now let's talk about the first condition. What is your name? Some of us might be praying because they know that this is the Sunnah of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they are doing the two rak'ahs according to the Sunnah. So now they have satisfied the two conditions. So inshallah, Allah will accept their deeds. And the second part of the hadith applies to them. وَإِنَّمَا لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مَا نَوَى. They will be rewarded by Allah because they satisfy the two conditions. Now here's the problem. Some of us might be praying because I was sitting and then I saw my friend of mine passing by. So I said, I want him to think I'm religious. I want him to think I'm pious. I want him to think I'm knowledgeable. And then I start praying the durakas. Now, the second part of the action, the second condition is satisfied. You're praying according to the sunnah. But how about the first part, your intention? It's purely for somebody else. Will you get any reward? No. This is the action of al-munafiqin. You're doing riya. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the authentic Qudsi hadith, he said, أَنَا أَغْنَى شُرَكَاءِ عَنِ الشِّرْكِ. I am the one who's the most less of need of any associates. I don't need any associates. No one to associate anybody with me. مَنْ عَمِلَ عَمَلًا أَشْرَكَ مَعْيَ فِيهِ غَيْرِ تَرَكْتُهُ وَشِرْكُ. Whoever does a deed and he made the intention that he's doing it for me and for somebody else. It's not for only for somebody else, for me and for somebody else. I would leave him and I would leave his deed. Right? So this is if you have two dual name. Now think about people doing things purely to please others when it comes to good deeds. Definitely there is no reward for them. And actually you might be getting sin. Right? Because these are the actions of the munafiqeen. This is what it means. وَإِنَّمَا لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مَا نَوَى. Now when it comes to this action of salah, inshallah, most of us will try to avoid this. But sometimes it happens. There is like a fundraising, or people are going outside and trying to put money in the boxes, trying to help the masjid, or trying to help Nizar, or any good deed, or any good cause. Make sure when you're doing that, your intention is purely for Allah. Your intention is purely for Allah. Otherwise, it's going to be devoid. Devoid. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not accept it. Right? So that's one thing. The other thing when it comes to niyyah, so that's the importance of the first part of the niyyah, or the importance, one importance of the niyyah is determining for whom you're doing the action. The second important thing about the niyyah, it helps differentiate different types of ibadah from each other. How so? Now, I come to the masjid and I start praying four rak'ahs. You have to have a niyyah before you start the prayer. Why are you praying this? Is this Salat al-Dhuhr? Is this al-Asr? Or is this Sunnah? And you can't switch your niyyah inside. The scholar said, a niyyah shart. It is a condition that has to start before the action or as you are starting it. You can't have a niyyah after you start the actual deed. Let me give you an example that a lot of us sometimes miss. Sometimes people are, let's say they are again in the masjid, or they see somebody or hear about somebody who needs some monetary help. And they give money, they give like $200, right? Without thinking about it. And then later, 2 weeks after, they say, oh, I have to start paying my zakat. Okay, I will consider those $200 that I paid 2 weeks ago as my zakat. No, because your intention has to happen before or right on when you are doing that deed. So that's the importance of the niyyah. Another example, let's say you missed fasting one of the days of Ramadan. You were traveling or you were sick. And now it was, you were in Shawwal. And then you decided one day at night, okay, I'll be fasting tomorrow. Midday, while you were fasting, they said, oh, I still have to fast one day, the day that I missed in Ramadan. I will consider this day that I missed in Ramadan. You can't. Your intention has to start before, your intention has to be there before you start the action of worship or the deed of worship. Now, an important aspect related to the niyyah as well. How do you do the niyyah?
The heart.
Just in your heart, jazakallahu khair. Only in your heart. It was never narrated. And I come from Egypt, and I see this happening a lot in our masajid in Egypt. People, before they start praying, they say, Nawaita salli al-Maghrib lillah qa'iman fi masjid al-Husayn. People start saying, I have the intention to pray al-Maghrib in this masjid, hadiran in its. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam never did that. And the niyyah is very important, but it's also very simple. Because you have to ask yourself, you took your car and you drove to this masjid and you stood in the line and it's the Maghrib time. Why are you here? Because you're praying in Maghrib. You don't have to make it more difficult than it is. So a niyyah, mahalluha al-qalb. The niyyah is in your heart. Actually, it is an innovation to utter the niyyah. You don't utter the niyyah. Even in al-hajj, you're not uttering. You're saying, labbaik allahumma bi umrah. That's not uttering. This is exactly like you say, Allahu Akbar. It is just saying, talabbasta bil ihram. You are entering in the ibadah. So, an-niyyah mahalla al-qalb. It is in your heart. Like this? Okay, so inshallah, I'll try to finish quick, inshallah. Now, another question that comes about the niyyah is, some people, when they hear about that, they do their best to hide their niyyah and hide their good deeds, which is good. Some of the Salaf al-Salih, our pious predecessor said, يَنْبَغِي الْمُؤْمِنْ أَنْ يُخْفِي حَسَنَاتِ كَمَا يُخْفِي زِيَادِ. Mu'min should try to hide his good deeds as he hides his bad deeds, to protect his heart from wanting to show off to people and then losing the ajr. But what if you're doing something good for the sake of Allah, and then somebody came and praised you, or talk to somebody else praising you? For instance, you were standing here, you came, the masjid was empty, and you started praying two rakas, and mashallah, you read a lot of Quran, you made a lot of ruku' and sujood. It took you like 15 minutes. And then after you finished, you didn't see anybody. Somebody came while you were praying, you didn't see him, and he saw you, and then once you were done, he told you, mashallah, brother, you prayed such a two rak'ah, mashallah, you have a lot of khushu'ah. Or he starts talking to others saying, brother, Majid, his mashallah prays very well, mashallah. Does this impact you in a bad way? No. Because in the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the authentic hadith, he was asked, some of us, after we do a good deed, people come and praise us. Would that impact us? So the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, تِلْكَ عَاجِلُ بُشْرَ الْمُؤْمِنِ. This is a prompt part of the good tidings that Allah is sending to the believer. So it's a good thing. As long as your niyyah was pure for Allah. So when that happens, don't worry. Inshallah, it's not going to impact your niyyah. But take it as a positive thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sending you glad tidings that inshallah you accept your deeds. Now, to finish the last part of the hadith, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, فَمَنْ كَانَتْ هِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ فَهِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. What does this mean? Again, it's not repetition. This is Rasulullah الَّذِي أُوتِيَ جَوَامِعَ الْكَلِمِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him the ability to convey the most wise words in a very concise form. So he's saying, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whoever does the migration for the sake of Allah and for his Prophet, then his reward will be from Allah and his Prophet. Allah will accept it and Allah will give him his reward. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam here is talking about the hijrah as just as an example of the good deeds. You can expand it to apply to all the other good deeds that you do. And then he gave the second part. What did he say? وَمَنْ كَانَتْ هِجْرَتُهُ. And whoever his migration was for لِدُنْيَا يُصِيبُكَ, for a worldly gain, أَوْ امْرَأَةٍ يَنْكِحُهَا, for a woman to marry, فَهِجْرَتْهُ إِلَى مَا هَجْرَ إِلَيْهِ. Then his migration is for whatever he migrated to. In the Arabic language, this is called تَحْقِيرُ, belittling. Saying that if it was for Allah and his Prophet, it is for Allah and his Prophet. And if it is for a worldly gain or for a woman to marry, then it is for whatever he married to. So he's now telling you that even this deed of the migration, if it was not done for the right intention, you will not get a reward. Right? Think about it as all the other deeds of Islam. Now, the importance of the right intention is, and I'm trying to find this hadith. I think I missed it. Now, the importance of the intention is, if you have the right intention purely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then something happens that prevents you from doing the good deeds, just based on your pure intention, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you the reward exactly as if you have done the good deeds. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in one hadith, he was in an expedition. He was in a ghazwa ma'a sahaba. And we all know that when they went for expeditions in the past, it was not like when we drive to Chicago, like they were taking camels, they were driving in the desert, you can lose water, they can die in the way, people can attack from all places. You know how difficult it was. And then the Sahaba were talking about, inshallah, that Allah will accept that ajr, and they were doing good deeds for the sake of Allah. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wanted to remind them about some other people. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ أَقْوَامًا بِالْمَدِينَةِ خَلْفَنَا مَا سَلَكْنَا شِعْبًا وَلَا وَادِيًا إِلَّا وَهُمْ مَعَنَا فِيهِ حَبَسَهُمُ الْعُذْرِ. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, they were in the desert, in the expedition. He said, in the Medina behind us, there are people whom we have left behind. We don't pass through any raven or valley, except they are getting the same reward as us. They have been kept behind due to valid excuses. So those people, although they were back in the Medina, they didn't do the actual deed, they didn't do the actual jihad, but they had the right intention, sincerely for Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them the same ajr. Allah, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the other hadith says, إِذَا مَرِضَ الْعَبْدُ أَوْ سَافَرَ كُتِبَ لَهُ مَا كَانَ يَعْمَلُ صَحِيحًا مُقِيمًا. If you travel, or if you become sick, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you the same reward for all the good deeds that you were doing when you were back home and you were in your full health. So what is that telling you? A bad niyyah, a bad intention, non-sincere, insincere intention can convert a very noble deed into the negative, as if it never happened. And a very good niyyah and a very good intention can convert no action into action with full reward. This is how important this hadith is. We finish up with this. Imam Ahmad radiallahu anhu, said, if I started writing 40 different books in Islam, every time I would start writing the book, I would start by putting this hadith in the beginning. I would put this hadith in the beginning. Also, the scholar said that مَدَارُ الْإِسْلَامِ عَلَى ثَلَاثَةِ حَدِيثٍ. The entirety of Islam, if you wanted to get like the most three comprehensive hadith in Islam, it would be three hadiths. This hadith from Sayyidina Umar, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ, actions are judged by your intentions. The second hadith from Sayyida Aisha, مَنْ أَحْدَثَ فِي أَمْرِنَا هَذَا مَا لَيْسَ مِنْهُ فَهُوَ رَدٌّ. Whoever innovates in this religion, it will not be accepted. And the third hadith is from Sayyidina Nu'man ibn Bashir, حلال بين والحرام بين. حلال is clear, حرام is clear, and between them there are dubious things. Those are the most comprehensive hadiths. So this is how important this hadith is. And the scholars usually started with it, hoping that inshallah they are starting their books with a sincere intention so that Allah accepts it from them. And we believe, wallahu a'lam, and Imam al-Nawawi, rahimahullah, had a pure intention. That's why his books are the most commonly used books in the masajid since he died till today. Look at here, look at what we're reading. This is the 14th hadith of Nawawi, and this is the Riyad al-Salih. This is what most people are reading. Both are written by the same man. So reminder for myself and for you, purify your intention. Take nearly a second before you start your prayer, giving zakat, or doing any good deed. Ask yourself, why am I doing this? And if you feel there is a mixture between doing it to please Allah and please others, purify it. That is for the sake of Allah, and remember, only Allah can reward you. Human beings cannot do anything. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم وجزاكم الله خيرا.